And I am therefore grateful to you for having advised us about the sensitivity of the situation and be restrained in the language that we use. Madam, I recall, because I spent a couple of years in the Ministry of External Affairs, that dealing with Sri Lanka was one of the easiest jobs while dealing with all our neighbors. Each one of them had some issue or the other, but it was only with Sri Lanka that we could deal on the basis of sovereign equality without any hang-ups either on their side or on our side. And this whole house is aware of the fact that Sri Lanka is one of our closest neighbors, that we have had a civilizational relationship with Sri Lanka, and in modern times, one of the most cordial. But at the same time, the tragedy of the Sri Lankan Tamils is one of the greatest tragedies of our times. And when you are dealing with a neighbor, it becomes very difficult to remain untouched by the events and the goings on which take place in that country. We have been affected. People who have been close to us in Sri Lanka have been badly mauled in this war. And the worst part is that the tragedy of the Sri Lankan Tamils continues. They have not only been massacred, abused, their human rights violated, atrocities committed. When the war was on, it is something, as my friend Mr. T.R. Balu has said, which continues even today. Any one of us who saw the picture or watched the video of that young child, 12-year-old, sitting in a bunker, then eating a biscuit, and then his dead body lying on the ground with 5 bullet holes in his chest, cannot remain unmoved by the tragedy of war. If the ugliest face of war was brought home to all of us in this whole long conflict, it is the picture of that innocent child being done to death in a manner which is clearly unacceptable. Madam, my colleague Mr. Balu has described the plight of the Tamils in great detail. I have no wish to revisit that issue in my intervention. But I would certainly like to raise issues of policy in this debate, because I think it is important for this House to tell the government of India what our policy towards Sri Lanka be in the changed circumstances. You are aware of the flip-flops in the past. I am not raising it in a spirit of partisanship, but facts of history are facts of history and cannot be really denied. What happened when the LTTE emerged is well chronicled. We first encouraged them, then we sent our army after them in Sri Lanka to destroy them. They could not be destroyed. 2,900 of our brave jawans and officers lost their life on Sri Lankan soil. There is no memorial to them, madam, in our country. Not yet. It's one of the greatest losses that the Indian Army has ever suffered. And we were back to square one because this policy achieved nothing. Now, we are all aware that in 2005, early 2005, there was a change of government in Sri Lanka. And the present president of Sri Lanka came into office by a very narrow margin. And they engaged the LTTE in a war. The war went on for a while. But they chose the moment of the final assault on the LTTE very carefully. And I want the House to take note of this fact, madam, that the final assault against the LTTE was launched when we were all engaged in the general elections of 2009. We were all busy, all of us here, those who did not succeed and are outside. The whole country was engaged in what? In elections. It was at that point of time that the government of Sri Lanka decided to launch its final assault against the LTTE and against the Tamils of Sri Lanka. And they won a famous victory. Their leader, the LTTE chief, was killed. His son was killed. Thousands of Tamils were butchered, civilians. Untold atrocities were committed. And the war came to an end with the final annihilation of the LTTE in the middle of May, when the results of the Lok Sabha elections were coming. You will remember that the counting for the Lok Sabha elections took place on the 16th of May that year. Unfortunately, the triumphalism became a state policy of Sri Lanka after that. And the spirit of triumph continues even today. What was happening, madam, in the government of India at that point of time? When all our attention was on the elections. There is a very famous book written by Nitin Gokhale, who was the defense and strategic affairs correspondent of NDTV, who covered this 33-month Elam war in great detail. And in his book called Sri Lanka from War to Peace, he has openly accused the government of India of being the hidden hand behind the success of the Sri Lankan army against the LTTE. And I'm quoting from that book, although in the initial days, the president was advised, president of Sri Lanka was advised to seek a negotiated settlement with the LTTE. New Delhi saw merit in Sri Lankan president's argument that the LTTE is only biding its time to regroup and rearm itself, and that war was inevitable sooner than later. New Delhi's only concern was that the war should be concluded before the summer of 2009, when India was expected to hold general elections. The Sri Lankan president suggested to New Delhi the idea of an informal exchange mechanism between the two countries and deputed a troika consisting of his two brothers who were holding various positions and his secretary, his own personal secretary. India reciprocated immediately, and our team consisted of the then National Security Advisor, the then Foreign Secretary, and the then Defense Secretary. This was the troika on both sides which was coordinating action. And the action was so well coordinated that the Indian Navy intervened and destroyed the Sea Tigers' vessels and broke their back. That was the strength of the LTTE. And once their back was broken, then there was nothing they could do. More importantly, the idea that there was no military solution to the conflict, which had been the centerpiece of our country's policy, was abandoned. From that time until the end of the Elam War, according to this book, we in India never again said publicly or even privately that there was no military solution to the conflict. The then NSA flew to Chennai in April 2009 and met the then Chief Minister and the President of Mr. Balu's party. He flew to Sri Lanka. Nothing happened. They were being told one thing in Chennai and something else in a different language was being conveyed to the Sri Lankan president. That was the duplicity of the policy that we were following at that point of time. This is not only evidence. The former commander of the Indian peacekeeping forces, Major General Ashok Mehta, said in June 2009, this is all contemporary evidence, and I quote, "We were complicit in the last phase of the offensive when a great number of civilians were killed. Having taken a decision to go along with the campaign, we went along with it all the way and ignored what was happening on the ground," unquote. Brad Adams, madam, the Asia Director of Human Rights Watch.
The name I'll have to expunge.
Okay, I'm just saying, okay,
please,
cut out the name. Asia Director of Human Rights Watch. He is not a government functionary.
That's okay.
He is the head of the Human Rights Watch. Mr. Balu was quoting the Human Rights. Said that India had failed to act when the Red Cross warned it of an unimaginable humanitarian catastrophe. India could have saved many lives if it had taken a proactive position. The Asia-Pacific Director of Amnesty International said, and I quote, "India simply chose to support the Sri Lankan government's notion that it could kill as many civilians as it would take to defeat the tigers." The most damning evidence, madam, is of course the statement of the then Defense Secretary of Sri Lanka, who also happens to be the brother of the Sri Lankan president.